about the way music could have a different place within our listening focus.
Music that almost wasn't music.
He's definitely at the of sound as music.
Taking it into a new ground.
Are you a musician? Are you a fine artist? Are you what?
Brian Eno was a pioneer.
Even though experimental music is not visible in the mainstream, then the influence is subtle and all-pervasive. And even though Brian Eno is not on Top of the Pops all the time, he was a very influential figure on the history of British music. And without him, we probably wouldn't be sitting here today.
But I don't know whether it's important or not, or I don't know in which way it's important.
Brian Eno has got to be one of the most important voices in Britain.
The first time I saw Eno was this strange wizard-like figure appeared with Roxy Music on the Old Grey Whistle Test. And he was processing Phil Manzanera or somebody through his VCS3 with a joystick and was totally in his own world, oblivious to the rest of the band.
My contribution was, I think, to do with threading in a lot of the stranger sonic and conceptual experiments that were going on in experimental music, trying to make those part of what could be done in music at the time.
It was like taking the studio on the stage. It was the beginning of this interface between, you could be the studio boffin, but you're doing it in public. And to me that was a new role that was more exciting than just being under the spotlight.
It was around the beginning of 1975 that he had a very bad car accident. While he was recuperating, he was visited by Judy Nylon, who was a singer who brought a record of harp music round to his flat. One of the loudspeakers wasn't working, I think, and it was all too quiet, but he was too ill and exhausted and in pain to get out of bed to adjust the record player. At the time, he described this way of listening as being like a tint within the atmosphere, so like a very pale wash of colour that you might not even notice. And that was really the beginning of his idea of ambient music.
And innovators like Eno were the forerunners of it, really.
It was stuff you just listened to in your bedroom that was not like any other music that other kids were listening to. Morning Star, or the stuff he did with Robert Fripp, all the Frippatronics, music for films, the ambient album, that was just like nothing you'd ever heard.
He had a very clear idea of how to speak to a bigger audience, which, let's face it, many people in experimental music and art had no idea about it at that time. You know, this was before the age of marketing.
I really liked On Land, the ambient record that seemed to be almost totally without melody or or harmony.
It's not just music, it's every sound is music.
What would I be playing if I wasn't me, but I was a bass player who'd grown up listening to Fela Kuti and Tamla Motown, and it was now the year 2005 and we're in a club on the outskirts of Tripoli.
I think My Life in the Bush of Ghosts was certainly a kind of seminal work.
And we're going to create music from ground zero. We're going to make a new culture, a new kind of music, and we're going to do it from ground zero. Make a record as a document of this culture, and it might be an interesting project.
that really was world-shattering, groundbreaking, brilliant record. And that's about just 20 years old now. But all this new, all that newfangled sampling and stuff, that was when it was really a new thing.
Impassioned voices from preachers or from field recordings or from all sorts of things.
Talking of, where the beginning of the dance rock crossover started, it didn't even start with New Order really, now that what the Talking Heads doing.
Whether he was an incredibly experienced producer or not, that didn't matter to us. The fact was that we thought he got what we were about. After a couple of records, he was really kind of part of the band.
That was an incredible album that, you know, a year or two earlier would have been seen as avant-garde music, but ended up being on the chart for a long time and sold, I don't know, but, you know, six-figure sales or something. Used to be in every household, and still a classic record today.
He moved towards the idea of installations, and you can see the influence of that kind of work in all kinds of areas, partly on the most obscure areas of sound art, and then, of course, with a big mainstream rock act like U2.
He's off at some fucking installation. You know,
I don't know, what, you know, is what he installing, like central heating? What is it?
What I really wanted was music that would last until you switched it off. 8 hours or forever. Well, I got to that in the end, but I had to wait until some other things were invented to be able to do it. In the meantime, the way I did it was by making installations which used multiple players, multiple cassette players, all of which were playing very long loops.
There were many, many interesting artists, musicians, composers beginning to explore multimedia work of various kind or installations of various kinds. But I think he was certainly one of the first very well-known figures from the area of popular music who moved into the arts.
Brian will create something and literally just leave it there for others to discover. And there's whole music movements that have grown up over ideas Brian had and kind of didn't really persevere with.
Ambient music went on to influence another generation in the late 80s when acid house was happening and rave culture was just beginning. The counter movement sprung up in all that madness and mayhem, which was the ambient scene, the kind of second generation ambient scene.
What were the skies like when you were young?
They went on forever. We lived in Arizona. Always had little fluffy clouds.
What helped the Orb was the fact that there was this mad producer who could make this kind of music. But what we wanted to do was like put bits over the top and turn it into modern ambient music. That it's a coined a phrase that, as our first single said, which was a huge ever-growing pulsating brain that ruled from the centre of the ultra world. On the backside of the 12-inch, it said, ambient house for an E generation.
We're at the Big Chill Gala. It's a beautiful Sunday. Sunday's the day for the chill out. On the seventh day, he chilled out. And here they are, chilling out most largely. Come down this field, see how many ENO tunes you hear this afternoon. It's probably in more DJs' boxes on this site than any party in the world. There are quite a lot of ENO collaborators actually doing sets here. And what other festival has an entire field full of installation art? For those who say, where's the ambient scene in the year 2000? I would say you need to be down here next year.
More than anything, I think Brian is a pioneer because he sees music as a sort of living, ongoing culture that constantly needs to be challenged and redefined.
This summer we'll be in Ibiza doing our Chilenium party, which, you know, is basically Eno's quiet club idea. Atmospheric music, videos, lights, performance art, in a lovely outdoor setting on the beach. And we're also playing the 20th anniversary of the Café Del Mar, which, you know, I remember the first time we ever went to the Café Del Mar, and they were playing a Penguin Cafe Orchestra track, which Brian Eno produced. And I'm sure they'll play it that night too, as the sun sets. Mm. So I think Eno's place, it's a shame he can't come, really. I think he should be there as the Don.
A lot of grumbling.
He's a classic Suffolk grumbler.
He says that people in Suffolk live longer because they grumble more. So we have to listen, to him moaning and groaning. And I must say, I'd miss it if it weren't there.